Hey y'all, I just wanted to come on here with a quick little disclaimer before we start today's video. I have literally tried to record this intro. This is like the third or fourth time and it's making me nuts. I think because I'm someone who really tries to be careful about what I say and don't want to be misinterpreted, but that's gonna happen no matter what I do, so here we go. This video is about analyzing the way the media chooses to cover certain types of missing bodies, those particularly of women, and how that coverage, that attention, that care is important. I mean, well, we'll get into the information of if the media really has as much influence on cases getting solved. We'll talk about that later. But it's still important for that recognition to bring awareness to those that go missing. And the media doesn't always do the best job of sharing that attention and spreading that awareness. And a lot of organizations and groups have to come and pick up that slack. So, as you know, on this channel, it's improv rules. Yes, and I'm not trying to make this video at any point for anybody, especially in the comment section, though I know it'll still happen, for people to be arguing with each other about whose life has more value, because that's hopefully you know by now we don't do that over here. But as you know, I don't just like to observe the thing and talk about it. I like to understand how we got here. So that's what this whole video is. That's what the purpose of this video is. Either way, just wanted to get that out there. I overexplain myself a lot. I'm a recovering people pleaser. Okay, I'm just trying to get center of the pumpkins because, hi, it's fall. It's already been fall, but like, it's spooky ooky season. This is my favorite time of year. I had plans to do a bunch of creepy videos, and then none of that sat right with me. So you've gotten the content that you have now. Sorry, y'all. I'm trying to make this intro lighthearted and stuff because I know that the video it's gonna be a bit like, But I may be overstating that. It might not be as, as I'm making it out to be. But either way, hello and welcome slash welcome back to my channel. My name is Khadija, and if you are new, please feel free to take a look around, suss out the vibe. I just sit in my workspace and talk about whatever I want. And today I am, today we're talking about a few things that have to deal with the way the media covers the missing, who they choose to cover and pay attention to, who gets left behind, who gets forgotten. The first way we're gonna do that is by talking about a concept known as no humans involved. If you've never heard of this, when you hear it, you're gonna be so irritated. Then after that, we're going to talk about the phenomenon known as missing white woman syndrome. We gotta talk about it. We gotta talk about it. Hard truths. We gotta just do that. And then we're gonna talk about the idea of deciding who's innocent and how that contributes to the way the media chooses to cover or not cover missing bodies. And then, as always, I'm gonna give you my final thoughts. I will show it. I have asked the artist if I could in this video, and I actually wanted to interview them, but they weren't available, so I'll just do my textual analysis about it and how it inspired this video. And yeah. So we're going to pay some bills so that we can make sure that everyone on the team is taken care of, and so that we can make sure we can donate some of these funds to the organizations that I listed below, or at least a couple of them. And then we're gonna get into it. Thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring today's video. Talked to y'all many times before about Skillshare. It's an online learning community with thousands of classes to inspire all sorts of creatives, novices, experts, whatever you want to call it. Skillshare helps you explore new skills, deepen your understanding of others, and just have a little bit of fun cultivating your curiosity. You can learn about film and video, marketing, freelance entrepreneurship, crafts, web development, photography. Y'all know I love all the writing classes, but a new class that I found that I really it came at the right time was Anna Gannon's Unlocking Your Potential: Five Exercises to Build Creative Confidence. So this video really came at the right time for me because Emma Gannon is, or calls herself, a multi-hyphenate, and that's kind of like my whole jam of being interested in a lot of things and wanting to do a lot of things. But I find myself getting imposter syndrome a lot because I'm like, who gives you the right to think that you can do all these things? Because you probably just aren't even good at all of them. You can't, you know. You know how the demonic voices get, you know. So this class was really great to take to just understand that all sorts of creatives, all kinds of artists, all sorts of multi-hyphenates, portfolio artists, whatever, we all go through it, and there are ways to catch yourself when you're in it and get out of it. It's like training a new muscle. So, if you're thinking about trying Skillshare, the first 1,000 subscribers to click the link in my description will get 1 month free trial of a Skillshare membership. So you can, as we always say, get started exploring your creativity. Thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring today's video, and let's get back to it. You may have heard a radio news report, which aired briefly during the days after the jury's acquittal of the policeman in the Rodney King beating case. The report stated that public officials of the judicial system of Los Angeles routinely used an acronym, NHI, to refer to any case involving a breach of the rights of young black males who belong to the jobless category of the inner city ghettos. NHI means no humans involved. So Sylvia Winter wrote those words in her paper titled No Humans Involved, An Open Letter to My Colleagues. And it was hard to pin down an exact year of when this paper came out. I think the first version was 1992 and it was published in full in 94, but in and around 92 and 94 is when this paper came out. And as I read in the quote, she's basically talking about how the LA Police Department, historically just known for debauchery, phew, they were using this acronym any single time they were breaching the human rights of black men that they were either, let's say, and I she didn't say this specifically, but the examples that I would think of that come to mind is any interaction that the cops would have with these young black males. They were using this acronym because those guys were jobless. They don't, quote, contribute to society. Those are my words. The police officers are using this acronym, and this is not the first time this acronym has come up. We'll talk about that in a bit, but basically using this again, yeah, to just say, okay, yeah, we can bang some suspects up. We can do this, that, or the other. They don't have jobs and they're black kids, black men in this urban area. They're not humans. And you can see how many people have used this sort of belief system without using that exact NHI acronym, because the whole idea is that members of the dominant group, let's say, view members outside of that dominant group as different, simply because of their look or because of their class difference, and as a result, think that that difference justifies treating them as non-human like them. It requires a lot of assumption and a lot of just plain old, like, buffoonery, because what? Either way, this sort of thinking of those that are in our dominant group versus not, and then labeling, or at least specifically with the LAPD, labeling those young men as NHI, once you categorize someone, it changes the way you see them. Once you put the label on someone of they are X type of person or not person at all, it colors the way you're going to treat them. And she's not alone in this observation, because Stephen Jay Gould said, quote, systems of classification direct our thinking and order our behaviors. As I've always said, language can be a fantastic tool for understanding, for communication, but unfortunately, a lot of times it can be used as a weapon. And this time it was a way to separate non-humans from humans. And in this case, the humans would be able-bodied, racialized white folks of a certain class. Winters was basically saying that by classifying these young men as NHI, no humans involved, the LAPD was essentially allowing whatever they wanted to be done to these non-humans to quell the riots that were going on in 92. And perhaps in my view, this labeling of no humans involved and the subsequent ability to just do whatever you wanted because they are animals, essentially, it was a way for a lot of these officers to justify and let out their pent-up racism, as well as using it as a sort of, as their force, as a sort of retaliation to get that pent-up anger out. And of course, a lot of them probably didn't think anything would happen, especially if you see all these officers getting acquitted after Rodney King, this blue wall of silence. It's like, all right, bet, fair game. Let's go hunting, boys. You know, it gives off that vibe. I'm just saying, hunting for sport, it really gives off that vibe. And taking it away from an American point of view, this isn't the first time this has happened, because Winter uses the Armenian genocide and the Holocaust as examples. And I think you could also use the Roma people as an example of that throughout Europe, because as long as there is a category of people that are marked as the other, as long as there's a group of people that can be marked differently than the dominant group, then there is a justification at all times for the oppression of that other group. As Helen Fine writes, "Not because they were aliens, but because the dominant group was alienated from them by a traditional antipathy." Helen Fine kind of talks about this sanctified universe of obligation. So the universe of obligation refers to the circle of individuals and groups towards whom obligations are owed, to whom rules apply, whose injuries call for amends. Basically, you are in the universe of obligation. We owe this to you. If you fit in the parameters of this dominant group, that you get to have your needs met, you get to get justice for things done to you, if it's harm or anything like that. If you go missing or someone you know goes missing, we have our universe of obligation to pay attention to that and to try and find you or bring you justice for whoever has murdered you. Do you see where I'm going? When I actually first heard about the concept of no humans involved, I was listening to an episode of My Favorite Murder, and I think Karen was the one who was talking about it. She brought up serial killer Lonnie Franklin and how he was able to get away with murdering sex workers for over 25 years because, like the young black males, the jobless black males in the inner city ghettos, the police officers working those cases decided that they were sex workers and they too were NHI, no humans involved. I think it's really important to consider the impact of that sort of classifying by those who are meant to serve and protect on sex workers, because it could just as easily be any of us. If racialized black and brown men that are jobless are deemed fair game to the cops based just because they don't have a job or whatever, and sex workers who do have a job are deemed that way because they don't have a job that society approves of, it might seem like I'm reaching to say that it could be any of us, because it couldn't necessarily be any of us. Let's get that straight. Some of us are in a certain class category that the chances of this aren't as likely, but I think, what does this mean then for particularly women, femmes, trans women that are non-white, even if they do have jobs? You know, what does this mean? For me, it means that when they go missing, chances of people rallying around to demand answers and hold police and politicians accountable to solving that case, those chances are a lot smaller, because not only are they being labeled as non-human, there's also this universe of obligation that we have to consider too. And if somebody is deemed non-human, they're outside of the parameters of that universe of obligation. Because at the end of the day, individuals classified and deemed worthy of protection are therefore deemed worthy of media coverage by the dominant group, the group that fits into Fine's, again, universe of obligation. And when we're talking about missing women, that tends to skew to those that are beautiful, cishet, able-bodied, straight-sized, white women of a certain class. And now we gotta talk about missing white woman syndrome. Listen, I know the title of this part is provocative, but just go with me, okay? So missing white woman syndrome is a term coined by the late Gwen Ifill, and it is to refer to how the mainstream media seems to only be interested in covering, quote, missing or endangered white women. And that was a general explanation from Jean Denby's piece in NPR. I did find a full definition, so I'm gonna read that one because I think that fleshes it out a little bit more. Missing white woman syndrome is a term used to show how incidents of missing young white women and girls from middle-class backgrounds receive national and even international attention for months on end, while others are ignored. This extends not only to young women of color, but also to women from lower socioeconomic classes. I would add as well, and this is something I think we all already know, that trans women aren't even considered in this when you look at this definition, that disabled women, fat women, you see, so more of us fit into the probably not fitting into the missing white woman syndrome than you probably think, but
Anyway, in Yasmine Lajoie's Refinery 29 article, What is Missing White Woman Syndrome? They talk about how this syndrome shows up in the UK and Europe. Between 2006 and 2016, countless young girls disappeared and have never been found. The names of some of them are Hidari Nestoran, Na Dang, Hayat Ahmed, Elizabeth Ogun Baibi, Kadia Diane, Na Ti Huang, and Amina Khan. They never dominated news cycles, nor do they have dedicated police task force looking for them. If they were ever reported on, it was a few vague sentences in a local newspaper. Yasmine Lajoie talks in this article about how parental abduction tends to be the most common, and she talk specifically about Amina Khan's case because she was kidnapped by her mother, but her father said, if Amina had been white, she would have been rescued. If I had been white, Amina would have been rescued. The police would have been involved. The courts would have helped. There would have been articles about her. The authorities were absolutely useless. And so she even used some information from Zach Sommers, a sociologist from Northwestern, who looked at every missing person in the US covered by four main media outlets in 2013. And he basically had a mix of local and national news outlets, news sources from different cities and different regions with contrasted demographic profiles. Like, he was just trying to get a bit of information. But the main places that he analyzed were coverage from Star Tribune of Minneapolis, the Chicago Tribune, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, and CNN. So taking all that information, he then cross-covered it or cross-analyzed it, I guess, with the FBI's National Database on Missing Persons, which he said maps relatively well with the country's broader demographics, I guess. But what he found was that white women were more likely to be the subject of news coverage, even more likely than men to be covered, than, I'm assuming, white men. It didn't say white men in here, but that white women make up a third of the US population. But according to Summers, quote, half of the articles in the data set are just about white females alone. He also noticed that the coverage of these missing racialized white women was different in its intensity too. Being repeatedly covered in turn drove up the number of articles that would be printed about these women. Or displayed online, I guess is a better way. By choosing to disproportionately highlight the experiences of whites and women, these four news websites are implicitly, or perhaps explicitly, intimating that the cases of those individuals matter more. And this is where I always rant about, because people, what does he mean when he says whites and women? Like, does he mean white men and white women? Does he mean racialized white men and white women? Does he mean women of all backgrounds? And, you know, like, it's about the specificity that I'm wondering. But either way, that's just a quote. I just read the quote. Summers goes on to talk about how coverage of the missing can be informed by a newsroom's racial makeup, and America's newsrooms tend to remain mostly white, which is kind of an interesting connection to when we talk about representation in the media, something as frivolous as having more representation on a TV show. Let's say it's not frivolous, but like in this context it is, because nobody's missing. But people will talk about how you have to have a more diverse or inclusive behind the scenes if you even want to have a hope of in front of it translating in front of the camera. And it's interesting to note that that's the same kind of connection with newsrooms, of if the newsroom is mostly white, if the victim is racialized as white, then that's what they're going to be paying more attention to than those that are not. It's an interesting connection. And of course, money plays a huge factor, because Summer speculates that missing white women will draw more eyes, which in turn draws more ad revenue. You really do have to always follow the money. That is wild. These are human lives. What? Jesus. The other thing to note about this, and we'll talk more about the stats in a bit, but in terms of missing white woman syndrome, is that the FBI, in terms of their missing database and stuff like that, don't distinguish white from being Latino. So the number of quote white people could actually be less, and they could actually be Latino, Latina, Latinx, or I think the other term a lot of people thought we were Latin. But yeah, that's the other interesting thing to note about that. And the FBI also doesn't break down race and gender combinations. So like, they will have a thing of, these are the number of black people that go missing, these are the number of white, but it's not necessarily gonna be black women. And the sad part about all of this is that even though I do believe that missing white woman syndrome with regard to the media and sometimes the internet is a thing, there isn't enough data to show support to the claim that media coverage or media exposure can actually help solve cases. So you might hear that and be like, then why are you worried about the way the media covers it if the media can't even, it just not even proven that the media can solve it? Listen to what I said. I said there's little data about it, so we don't actually even know if people maybe did a huge research, whatever, campaign, study, whatever, maybe we'd have information, irrefutable information, sure. But also, and this is where I'm gonna read from Sommer's quote because I think this is important, media attention shapes how and to whom people extend their sympathies. I think conceding that the people who are most cognitively easy for us to accept as victims are girls and women is problematic on its own, Summers said. Then we start to think about race in conjunction with that. Then the issues start to multiply even further from there. And he is absolutely right, in my opinion. The media, as I've talked about many times on this channel, shapes your relationship to the world around you, whether you know it or not. And so if the images of the missing and the murdered look a certain way or of a certain body ability, are of a certain hue, complexion, ethnicity, racial identity, whatever you want to call it, are straight-sized, are cis women, it's going to shape who you extend your sympathies towards to an extent, because we can't blame the media for everything, you know? But I do think that it is really important to, even if we can't without any shadow of a doubt say that if something gets more media coverage, it'll be solved. I know we can't say that, but we can at least say that it'll extend sympathies and attention to people who maybe would not have otherwise carried that or gone out of their way to get that information. The way internet sleuths operate too, you never know who could see that story and start dissecting online and even doing what, a Michelle McNamara and helping to solve an old case. You never know. So even if the media can't fix or solve cases, that's not their job. But it is their job to share information, to make people, their audience, aware of things that they would not have been aware of. They wouldn't have gone out and sought on their own. And that's why it's important to consider this missing white woman syndrome and the people that the majority that it ultimately leaves behind. And then we gotta talk about innocence.
So in talking about the way the media chooses to cover the missing, how the internet then gains a hold of that and starts to disseminate that information and internet sleuths and all of those sorts of things, I think it's important to recognize that this is a sociological issue and one that has to be examined under I'm so tired of even hearing the word critical, even though I say it, I'm like, huh. But you know, because the question that I'm asking is, who is deemed innocent and therefore worthy of protection in society and why? And as Sommers was saying before, you know, if men go missing, they're not going to be as covered as women are. I don't think that he's wrong about that, because I think it's about who we want to protect in society. And it's been a long running narrative of women and children, protect the women and children. But it's a very specific type of woman or a specific type of children, if you catch my drift. And I'm not the only one who's been asking myself these questions, because in 1986, Norwegian criminologist Niels Christie, or Nils Christie, I'm not sure, someone correct me, but he published a paper describing the ideal victim and what they might look like. And Antonia, who fact-checked this script, helped me find a concise way to explain his definition of the ideal victim. By ideal victim, I have instead in mind a person or a category of individuals who, when hit by crime, most readily are given the complete and legitimate status of being a victim. So someone that we think would maybe collectively as a society falls into the ideal victim is an elderly person. You know, if somebody walks down the street and punches an old woman in the face, almost all of us are going to be like, you know? So that's in the easiest ways, that's an ideal victim that I think most of us, maybe some people who hate the elderly, might. Jesus. Anyway, we're not gonna go down that road. But his theory implied a sort of hierarchy of victimhood within society, where the, quote, most vulnerable, respectable, and blameless, end quote, victims garnered the most sympathy. So again, I use an elderly person as an example, but within our society, you see, if we think about missing white woman syndrome and no humans involved, the people who fall into that category, it gets more narrow and narrow and narrow until you get something like missing white woman syndrome. And I think there are more than two things at play here. But in terms of his ideal about a vulnerable, respectable, and blameless person, it makes me think a lot about the way the media chooses to cover those who are missing and murdered, whether it's through someone they know or through some sort of serial killer or anything like that. Because who is our ideal of the most vulnerable, respectable, and blameless? In America, I always think of it, and Canada, because Canada really tries to be like America, but doesn't want the blame. It's very much the girl next door. And if you ask someone, who do you think the girl next door is, based off of depictions that you've seen in the media, based off of what you know, a lot of times people have a cis, able-bodied, straight-sized, young, racialized white woman who is beautiful and is from a middle-class background and got along with everyone, and how could this happen? From Sarah Stillman's The Missing White Girl Syndrome, Disappeared Women and Media Activism. If you look at coverage of missing middle-class white girls, the media provides a toolkit for how to have empathy for them. Stillman explains, here's a picture of them as a baby. Here's their family. Here's instructions on how to give a shit. That's not afforded to other types of victims. It all comes down to who gets afforded the privilege of media attention and who is considered disposable. Again, the media gets to create this narrative and shape audience sympathy if we aren't paying attention. In the US, I think the history of putting women to the category of worthy female victim and having it typically skew towards white, middle-class, able-bodied, cis, beautiful, all that kind of stuff is, to me, I think it can be traced back to the KKK. You know, there are those ideas of how white men, we gotta protect our white women from the black boogeyman and blah, 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 blah. And so, and people have talked about this with Karens and stuff too. Antonia put a couple of articles and stuff in there that I'll link as well in the works cited. But I think that you can't remove that legacy from understanding how it trickles down into something like a missing white woman syndrome. And then when you're thinking about no humans involved, and let's say we go to England, this has happened a lot in the States too, but we're gonna go over to England with the Yorkshire Ripper. To me, it seems like, even watching the documentary series about it, the docuseries, how the way they talked about sex workers, because it was implied that a lot of his victims were sex workers, so they knowingly put themselves in harm's way and yada, yada, yada. And in Sarah Stillman's paper that will be linked below, she talks about this woman that went missing and how everyone was all covering the news. And in like the small, you know how the news will have those headlines and stuff running underneath? She sees something that says, found a body that was not Jessica. And she's just like, the body that was not Jessica. And even before I finished reading the paper, I was like, so we all are either Jessica or we are not Jessica, in terms of how the media would cover a lot of us if we went missing or were murdered, which is horrible to think about. I would really recommend y'all read Sarah Stillman's paper, because she doesn't just say, oh, missing white woman syndrome is so annoying, blah, blah. And Sarah Stillman is, as far as I can tell, a racialized white woman. So maybe that'll make some of y'all come into her paper with a bit more ease. I'm not judging you, I'm just saying. She also talks about how media activism, tools that we can use to kind of counteract this syndrome or this narrative or this lack of attention. So one of the first things she talks about is naming. She said that naming adds specificity and it also humanizes those that are missing. She even adds a second category to missing white girl syndrome, which is missing pretty girl syndrome. And I think that that's also important. This expanding vocabulary, when applied with care, can help raise questions about who profits from turning attractive white female victims into national commodities, and by extension, how we might counteract the myth of brown women's disposability. So because you gotta look at things from many different angles, even her bringing that up I think is important, because these victims, missing and slash or murdered, that are the pretty middle class white girl, they have no say over how they get depicted in the news. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's not
Yeah.
So how does the media then commodify these women's bodies, and then also while simultaneously treating racialized black and brown women's bodies as disposable, or treating non-white, I should say, bodies, disabled bodies, fat bodies, trans bodies as disposable. It's like you have to have there has to be the equal and opposite. And when you do it with humans, as I've said before, it's very messy and unnecessary, but for some reason it seems to happen all the time. So another tool that she adds with naming for media activists trying to counteract this missing white girl syndrome or missing pretty girl syndrome is also using satire or critical humor against newsrooms. But she talks about how this way is a bit limited. Satire has the potential, when carelessly wielded, to invite the very kind of dehumanization that it claims to resist, belittling the suffering of white female victims and those who mourn them. And that's why I put the disclaimer at the beginning of this, to say, you know, I'm trying my best not to make this funny, jokey, but I'm also still trying to add elements of relief, because one, this is a heavy topic, and two, in no way, shape, or form am I trying to say or insinuate that missing pretty middle-class white women don't deserve any of the attention that they get in missing, and their families have to deal with it, or making fun of these victims' families, because that is not only insensitive, it's like, to me, that's just dumb and counterproductive. Like, it actually is like irritating in my mind that people would do that. I'm sorry, I laugh when I'm uncomfortable, because I'm just like, what? In my mind, it's not our job to belittle other people's suffering, and that's not the intention or purpose of this video. So if you're trying to use this video for that purpose, good luck. No. Because the whole point is to point out that there is a discrepancy. There is a heavily skewed direction that the media likes to go in. And I think more people than not are sensible and aren't saying any of that sort of thing. But you always gotta, YouTube, the internet, all of it, once you put it out there, it doesn't belong to you. Doing my best to be as clear as possible with the intentions and yeah. The second major tool Sarah Stillman talks about is theatrics, the framing of a story around a missing person. She talks about using images and symbols and using even your own body as a stage in a way to get the attention for the missing. And she talks about different sort of activist tools that people have used to get either governments or the media or politicians to pay attention to people's missing loved ones. It also reminds me of this Radio Lab episode that I listened to. I think it's called Ashes on the Lawn. Please listen to it, because I don't fully remember the specific details and I don't want to get it wrong and Antonia didn't fact check this, but essentially people were fed up with the AIDS epidemic. We're like, this is some bullshit. The government is not doing anything to help us. This is an epidemic. What is going on? You know, homophobia is real. So of course the government wasn't doing that much. And they went to go protest at the White House. And then I think it maybe just started with one person. I don't think it was planned, or maybe it was, I can't remember, but they just started throwing the ashes of their cremated loved ones on the lawn. And that may seem extreme to some people, like what the heck? But to me, that's another way of activist theatrics, in a way of like, this is how we're gonna get your attention. You will see sometimes with some people, if there have been many members of their community missing or they're mourning, you'll have people wearing shirts with their faces on it. You know, just different things like that. That's what she was talking about using your own body as a stage, you know? And she uses some pretty good examples in the article. My brain is like fried right now, and I realized I didn't take notes on that, but it's highlighted in there, so check it out. But again, the thing that I also love about Stillman is that she considers how this can go a little too far and says that there needs to still be a centering of the person's life instead of, quote, embalming them in death. So in Canada, in BC, there is a highway called the Highway of Tears, and it's about 800 kilometers, and it's said that since 1994, at least more than a dozen Indigenous women have gone missing there or have disappeared there. And even between the late 60s and the early 80s, that number seems to be at almost 20. Quote, Aboriginal women aged 25 to 44 are 5 times more likely to suffer a violent death than other women in Canada. Of 500 cases documented by Amnesty International and the Native Women's Association of Canada, half haven't been solved. According to the report, 1,017 women and girls identified as Indigenous were murdered between 1980 and 2012, a homicide rate roughly 4.5 times higher than that of all other women in Canada. Studies in the United States have shown that darker-skinned women receive less coverage than white women, but so do women who are at higher risk for violence, such as sex trade workers, women living in poverty, and those with drug addictions. A red hand over the mouth has become the symbol of a growing movement, the Murdered and Missing Indigenous Women Movement. It stands for all the missing sisters whose voices are not heard. It stands for the silence of the media and law enforcement in the midst of this crisis. It stands for the oppression and subjugation of Native women who are now rising up to say, no more stolen sisters. This next set of stats is from an article about a website called Our Black Girls. Black girls and women go missing at high rates, but that isn't reflected in news coverage of missing persons. In 2020, of the 268,884 girls and women who were reported missing, 90,333, or nearly 34% of them, were Black, according to the National Crime Information Center. Meanwhile, Black girls and women account for only 15% of the U.S. female population, according to census data. In contrast, white girls and women, which includes those who identify as Hispanic, made up 59% of the missing, while accounting for 75% of overall female population. And the last one that I have here is actually about Australia. In Western Australia, Aboriginal people make up 17.5% of unsolved missing persons cases, despite making up just 3% of the state's population. Those are just some quick stats. I definitely encourage y'all to go through the Works Cited, read Sarah Stillman's paper, like just, it's, I think this is something that we'll get into the final thoughts and I'll let you know what I think. So, whew, gosh. Okay, it wasn't as heavy as I thought it would be because I was just more so talking about the observation. It got heavy and sad, especially during the stats part. But I think that it's important to know this stuff. I think it's important to share this information because if you're saying to people, listen, I feel for victims' families, those that go missing, all of this sorts of stuff, but X people only make up this part of the population and are twice as likely to go missing or blah, blah, blah. That kind of adds a bit more, I don't know, bite to the conversation, which is unfortunate that people even have to do that because it's like, why not just take my word for it? But so many people, It's hard, as I've talked about a lot on this channel, for some people to extend their empathy beyond people that don't look like them or people that they don't look like people that they know or could know, if that makes sense. And so unfortunately, sometimes you have to just not only say, listen, this is what's happening, and also be like, and Amnesty International is talking about it too, or the National Crime whatever Center is talking about it too. You know, it's really unfortunate that that has to be the case for a lot of these issues, particularly when it comes to missing and murdered women, femmes, trans women. I think any of us, even if it doesn't seem likely to some of us, any of us could all of a sudden be missing, or any of us could disappear off the face of the earth. And it's really disheartening to think that a lot of us could be classified in the not Jessica's body category as opposed to Jessica. Do you know what I mean? I think, as much as, yes, it is our individual responsibility to go out of our way to really see the humanity in all people, people that occupy all types of bodies. I think it really is an individual responsibility. The media has a job, journalists have a job to bring you the information that you would not have sought otherwise, to fact check that information and to spread it to as many people as possible, to hold politicians and governments as accountable as we do, but they wield a certain other power in being able to filter out the nonsense, you know? And when you have newsrooms with a mostly racialized white crew, cast, all that stuff, and they haven't done that individual work of considering the humanity, or even having that in the front of their mind, of all different types of bodies and all different types of occupations, in different class structures and stuff, then it's very easy for them to just cover the quote Jessicas and leave the rest of us in that not Jessica category. And they may not realize that it's treating those of us in the not Jessica's body category as disposable. It might not seem that deep to some of them, but when you're talking about missing people and murdered people, it is that it is that deep. It is that serious. And again, we know that there isn't enough data to talk about how media coverage, or if media coverage even helps with solving cases, but the internet sleuths out there are pretty miraculous. And I think even getting the attention to them is something that could be valuable. So I don't know if you're somebody that works in the media, works in journalism or something like that, and you've maybe come up with these issues of like wanting to cover stories of missing and murdered women that don't fit into the Jessica category, let's say. And I apologize, I'm not trying to make anyone whose name is Jessica feel bad or anything like that. I'm just doing it because it fit with the paper. If you can comment below maybe and let me know if there's some bureaucracy things that just happen, because at the end of the day, like Summers was saying, you know, media companies are about making the money. And if the ad dollars are about a JonBenet Ramsey, if that's what's going to bring advertisers in and bring the money in, that's what it seems like a lot of them are going to go with, which is very unfortunate. And I hope that tide is changing. I remain cautiously optimistic. I also think, and I'm sorry that I keep saying the media, because but I think the media also is good at creating a narrative and creating a story and showing people what they should care about. And so even if, yeah, the ad dollars go, if we are more likely to happen if we're talking about a Jessica than a non-Jessica, then I think it's maybe up to a few brave, I don't know, media outlets, news outlets, whatever, to just bite the bullet and be like, well, let's cover what's not being covered and set the precedent, you know? It's alarming to me to think that cable news is just entertainment at this point. And it might just be. I'm not trying to say that, but it just, it's kind of yucky feeling to think that it's just about ad dollars and what's gonna get the most people watching and not about actually telling and informing people about what's going on. But I haven't had cable in years, so. Whew. Anyway, I don't really know what else to say at the end of this besides, like I said, through this research, I found a few organizations that will be in the description that you can check out. Anyway, there's not really much else I can say. I just hope that this, as well as any of my other videos, for those of you that have noticed this thing going around and didn't have a name for it or didn't understand just how high this thing goes, you know, I hope that it gave you a language and a better way to articulate or even just start get your thoughts moving. For those of you that had never heard of something like No Humans Involved or Missing White Woman Syndrome or anything like that, I hope that it gave you that information, that initial guide to start doing your own research. I don't really know what else to say because, again, there are some things that you can make lighthearted and fun and yakety schmackety, and this is not one of those things. There might be outtakes after this, or I don't think I'm even gonna do outtakes after this. I think I'm just gonna let it be musicless and let the credits roll because that's just what feels right. So thank you very much for watching this video, and I'll see y'all in the next one.